Good afternoon to all. Welcome to the Singapore Management University and to this Shaw Foundation Distinguished Faculty Lecture Series. My name is Kevin Kwa, and I am a second year SMU student from the School of Information Systems, and I will be your MC for today. In collaboration with the Ministry of Trade and Industry and Civil Service College, we are pleased to present our speaker, Professor Dale W. Jorgenson, Samuel W. Morris University Professor from Harvard University. Professor Jorgenson will be speaking on the topic, The Rise of Asia and the New Economic Order, after which a panel discussion will follow. I would also like to acknowledge our panelists who are here with us this evening, Professor James Tang, Dean, School of Social Sciences, Singapore Management University, and Mr. Yeoh Lam Keong, Vice President, Economic Society of Singapore. Our chairperson for this evening's session is Professor Rajendra Srivastava, Provost and Deputy President for Academic Affairs of Singapore Management University. I would now like to invite Professor Rajendra Srivastava to give us a more detailed introduction of our speaker for this evening. Professor Raj, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's really a testament to the importance of this event and to our distinguished speaker that we have a very distinguished audience out here. So I was looking over the list of attendees, and we're really honored to have so many distinguished guests. They're from the diplomatic corps, they're from the ministries, they're from the civil service, they're from the academic institutions, and so there are lots of electrons floating around in the air in this room. So I can't thank everybody. You know, we have a lot of distinguished guests, so I can't name everybody. So I want to thank you all collectively for gracing SMU with your presence. I also want to thank the Shaw Foundation. And this is an annual event for us and the Shaw Foundation Distinguished Faculty Lecture Series is an important event at SMU. It allows us to connect with the business community, with the community at large. And it was established, the lecture series was established in 2002. And this was in recognition of the broad support that we have received from the Shaw Foundation. The series was established to promote a deeper understanding and appreciation of global issues and to also connect our community with what is going on in the fast-changing global environment. The aim of the lecture series is to be inspired by and to learn from people whose works and lives have a profound impact on the world around us. And on behalf of SMU, I'd like to thank the Shaw Foundation for the foresight and generosity once again. We're also very grateful to the Ministry of Trade and Industry and to the Civil Service College for co-sponsoring this event and for bringing our distinguished speaker to us. Now let me proceed to introduce Professor Dale Jorgenson, our distinguished speaker. Professor Jorgenson is the W. Samuels University Professor at Harvard University. He's an elected fellow of the American Association for Advancement of Science. The American Statistical Association and the Econometric Society. He's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, the US National Academy of Sciences and the American Philosophical Society. Professor Jorgenson served as the president of the American Economic Association and was named a distinguished fellow of the American Economic Association in 2001. I could go on and on and on, and all you have to do is go to Wikipedia to look at that, but I won't go on and on. And what I do want to sort of summarize is that Professor Jorgenson is the author of 246 research articles and counting. And he's the author or editor of 33 books. So that pretty much summarizes things. His collective papers have been published in 10 volumes by the MIT Press. So we see the contributions there. But I also want to note that Professor Jorgenson's contributions are really both deep and broad. His work is truly interdisciplinary. It's not just in economics, it reaches into statistics and econometric methods and into, you know, investor behavior, into consumer behavior, and really, really, you know, delightful breadth of interdisciplinary research. Let me just say a few words about these contributions. Professor Jorgenson received the prestigious John Bates Clark Medal from the American Economic Association in 1971 for his work that was bridging the world of economics and the world of statistics. Several of my colleagues at SMU, yours truly included, were familiar with the work that he has done when we were in graduate school, and we've learned a lot from you, Professor. And his research has spanned cutting-edge econometric methods, providing both interesting and meaningful alternative interpretations for the drivers of productivity. Professor Jorgenson has conducted groundbreaking research on information technology and economic growth, energy and the environment, tax policy and investment behavior, and applied econometrics. On a personal level, being a US citizen, I'm fascinated by your proposals on fair taxes. Okay, without going much further and without further ado, may I now invite Professor Dale W. Jorgenson on the stage.
Well, I'm very grateful to Singapore Management University and to the Civil Service College and to the Ministry of Trade and Industry for the opportunity to be with you tonight to discuss the issue of the rise of Asia and the New World Order. This is a topic that's discussed a lot these days, and my focus is obviously going to be on the world economy. The world economy is still in the process of recovery from the most severe economic downturn in the last century. So it's a very, very difficult situation. The US and Europe and Japan, so-called advanced economies, have been growing very, very slowly and recovering very, very slowly. And there's always the possibility, of course, that some new shock could arrive and disturb the ongoing recovery of the world economy. For example, these days it's very much in the news that we may be facing a collapse of the euro, that Italy and Greece and Spain, Portugal and Ireland may have to go through the equivalent of some kind of sovereign bankruptcy. But there are questions about emerging economies as well. For example, will China be able to manage the inflationary pressures that have resulted from the so far very successful stimulus program that was adopted in response to the global crisis? Will India be successful in undertaking a fiscal consolidation, which is going to be required to deal with the imbalances in the government budget in that country? Well, obviously, we could spend a lot of time on these issues of recovery, but what I'd like to focus on today is the long-term prospects for the world economy, and in particular, the role of Asia. So let me announce my theme in advance. My theme is that the world economy is undergoing a massive reconfiguration that has been unfolding since the epochal reforms of India and China more than two decades ago. But during the next 10 years, these changes are going to come to fruition, and we're going to be facing a new world order. And that's the theme that I'd like to lay before you tonight. I'm going to focus on the rise of developing Asia. So let me define that term. By developing Asia, I mean the countries of South and East Asia excluding Japan. So, in particular, I want to focus on the newly emerging economies, Singapore, Taiwan, Korea, and Hong Kong. But it's going to be also important to focus on the massive economies of India and China that have followed the path that was first initiated by Japan, then followed by the Four Tigers, and is now rapidly spreading throughout developing Asia. Altogether, there are 16 countries that I'm going to consider, and I'm going to be focusing on the fact that these are countries that, by and large, have survived the economic and financial crisis with growth trends essentially unscathed, unlike advanced countries in Europe and North America. What I would like to do is, in fact, focus on the trends that you see here, three major trends in the development of the world economy. The first is that China will overtake the United States during the next 10 years. In fact, if I had to pin it down, I would say in the year 2018. Could be 2 years earlier, could be 2 years later. But this is a momentous historical development. According to the definitive estimates of Angus Madison, the late Angus Madison, the U.S. has been the world's leading economy for a century. And by 2018, the U.S. will be displaced by China. Here, I think it's necessary to be precise. China, as we heard, overtook Japan in the year 2010. And there was a great deal of discussion of this in the press. But of course, economists view this as past history, because the press focused on the fact that China overtook Japan in terms of exchange rates, converting Chinese economic activity to Japanese activity equivalents by means of the yen-yuan exchange rate. The concept that I'm going to use, and that most economists would prefer, is the concept of purchasing power parity. Purchasing power parity. So what do I mean by that? Purchasing power parity is the relative price of output in one country expressed relative to that of another. And in terms of purchasing power parity and the gross domestic product of the two countries, China overtook Japan 7 years earlier, according to the estimates of the International Comparison Project at the World Bank. So I'd like to emphasize that when I say that China overtakes the US in the year 2018, I'm referring to purchasing power parities, looking at a unit of the output of the Chinese economy in terms of the price relatives vis-a-vis the corresponding output of the US economy. And this, of course, is a rather different perspective than the perspective of exchange rates. The second thing that I'd like to emphasize, and this is something that is equally important in my view, is that developing Asia, the 16 countries I mentioned, excluding Japan, so the four Asian tigers, China, India, and so on, will overtake the G7 in the same year, 2018. Remember that the G7 consists of the advanced countries of Europe and North America. These would include the US, Canada, the UK, Germany, France, Italy, and have I missed something? Japan. So when we say that developing Asia has overtaken the G7, again, we're looking at a historic development. The G7 was first convened in 1975. Canada was added in 1976. 35 years have passed since the G7 was the leading Organization of Advanced Economies, and this is already history. Deliberations about international coordination of economic policies are now taking place through the G20, a much broader group that includes many of the countries of developing Asia. So that's the second trend that I'd like to discuss. It turns out that this change, developing Asia overtaking the G7, is something which is mainly the result of Chinese economic growth, but with a very important contribution from India. And the final trend that I'd like to discuss is the emergence of a new world order in which a number of other very important developments have taken place. In particular, India will overtake Japan, Russia will overtake Germany, and Brazil will overtake the UK. So the New World Economic Order, the G7, if you like, of the future, at the end of the decade of 2010 through 2020, is going to look very different than it looked even a year ago. The leading economy, again, in terms of purchasing power parity, is going to be China, not the US. Next in the international order is going to be the United States, and then India, which will have overtaken Japan. Finally, Japan, Russia, Germany, and Brazil. These are going to be the leading economies of the world as we emerge from the next decade. What I'd like to do now is to give you an idea about how I arrive at these conclusions. And here I'm going to draw on my joint work with Professor Vu Min Quang, to use the order that's appropriate for Singapore, professor at the National University here in Singapore, who has been a collaborator with me on a series of papers dealing with international comparisons. Our idea is to make use of comparisons of output that are based on the International Comparison Project that I mentioned earlier by the World Bank, but we're going to combine that with something that is not part of the International Comparison Project, and that is an analysis of the sources of the growth of output in all of the countries of developing Asia and the countries with which I'm going to compare them. So for that purpose, what I'm going to have to do is to fill a very important void in the International Comparison Project, and a void which unfortunately characterizes a great deal of the discussion of the world economy, namely the input side. Where did this growth of output take place? What are the sources? And I'm going to identify capital input, labor input, and productivity, defined as output per unit of input, as the sources of the changes that have taken place. So my goal then is going to be to add to the International Comparison Project that provides an indicator of the levels of output of these various countries, an explanatory framework that incorporates the growth of capital, the growth of labor, and the growth of productivity as sources of the changes in output that have taken place. This is a concept that is relatively new for economists. The basic ideas have been around for a long time, but there have been very, very important changes. The most important of which is that around the year 2000, economists began to focus on the idea of capital as a service, not capital as a stock. So in order to understand the impact of information technology, people had to focus on the special character of the services provided by information technology and to compare those with other forms of capital, which I'm going to refer to as non-information technology, using the same concept of a service flow. Why do we use the services of capital rather than the stock? Because we want to compare the sources of growth
with respect to labor and capital. And labor is always been measured in terms of services. We think of labor services as work hours, but there's a very important dimension of labor input that is often overlooked, which is that hours worked differ enormously among different workers and across different countries, depending on the quality of the labor input. And so that's going to be a very important concept. Finally, I'm going to arrive at a concept of a source of economic growth based on productivity, where productivity is defined as output per unit of both capital and labor inputs. And that concept of productivity has the economic name of total factor productivity. Economists have not been terribly clear in distinguishing this from labor productivity, output per hour worked. So I'd like you to remark now that output per hour worked is a different concept than the concept of productivity that I'm going to use, which is total factor productivity. Why do we care about this distinction? Why is this an important issue? It's an important issue because with this definition of productivity and with the role that I'm going to assign to capital and labor, we can tie the sources of economic growth to specific policy changes that have been made and are promoting growth in Asia and around the world. So the chief novelty of this particular view of the rise of Asia in the New World Order is that it makes use of the framework for analyzing the sources of economic growth that has emerged in the last decade or so from the analysis that I described, focusing on information technology. What I'm planning to do is to emphasize the idea that we're going to have sub-periods beginning in 1990 in which information technology first emerged as an important source of economic growth. So I'm going to divide the recent history of the world economy beginning in 1990 into five-year intervals. Before 1995, information technology was a relatively modest part of the story, as we're going to see. From 1995 to 2000, there was a boom in investment in information technology in the US, in Singapore, around the world. And then finally, after the year 2000, there was a crash, the famous dot-com crash, restoring the previous proportions of information technology and other forms of investment. And finally, I'm going to look at the recent period after 2005, which is the period of the great economic crisis. For focusing on the importance of information technology, I'm going to use this concept of capital input as a service flow. And I'm going to measure the contribution of information technology, which I'm going to define as computers, communications equipment, and software, by weighting the growth rate of each of these forms of capital by the share of the property income generated by that form of capital in total property income. So the capital contribution of information technology is the contribution that I obtain by weighting computers, communications and equipment and software by the share that each of those generates in total capital income for the economy. I'm then going to do the same for non-information technology capital, and that will give me my story of the contribution of capital input to the total picture. The second thing that I'm going to do then is to apply the same concepts to labor input, and then finally to total factor productivity. And then I'm going to use the results of an analysis of the experience of the last 20 years to generate projections of the future of the world economy over the next 10 years. And it's this period during which the trends that I've described here are going to emerge. Well then, to summarize, I'm going to focus specifically on capital. I'm then going to talk about sources of growth, and then finally I'm going to talk about the future growth of the world economy. So that's going to be our agenda. Well, let's begin then with a look at the capital input contribution of the U.S. economy. That's a starting point. The U.S. is still the world's largest economy. And we see here the contribution of capital defined in the way that I described before. So remember I said that the contribution is the share of each form of capital, IT versus non-IT, in total property income, used as weights for the growth rates of these IT and non-IT components. So during the period from 90 to 95, the dark blue represents the contribution of information technology, the light blue, non-information technology. Although economists were largely unaware of this at the time, information technology, defined as investment in computers, telecom equipment, and software, already accounted for about half of the contribution of investment to economic growth in the United States. However, after 95, there was a huge investment boom in the United States, a leap in the contribution of capital input, which again you still see here in dark blue, and a corresponding increase in non-information technology. Information technology actually came to predominate. Think of how remarkable this is. Three assets, software, computers, and telecom equipment, came to predominate over all of the equipment, all of the structures, all of the inventories, all of the land in the rest of the economy. After the crash in the year 2000, information technology went back to something approximating its earlier portion. There was a decline in the contribution of non-information technology. And then, as we proceeded to the period of the crisis, the role of information technology continued at about the level that it had been before the great investment boom of 1995. Well, that's our story then about the contribution of information technology. And so now let's jump ahead and first of all have a look at the importance of information technology in the world economy. I don't have time to go through all the details here, but you can see that there was a similar increase, about half as much actually, in the world economy contribution of information technology after 95. There was a bit of a reduction and then a revival, and then we begin to see divergent trends. In the G7, there was a pattern very much like the United States, but in developing Asia, investment continued at higher rates. And by the end of the period, investment in information technology in developing Asia was running at about twice the rate of the advanced countries of the G7. Well, this is obviously a momentous development, a tremendous shift. If we focus more specifically on the seven countries of developing Asia that I've described here, China, India, the Four Tigers of Hong Kong, Singapore, South Korea, and Taiwan, and Indonesia, we see that the trends in developing Asia mirror those in China, which had emerged as a dominant economy. But you can see that in the development of Singapore, there is a clear distinction between the period before and after the year 2000. Up until the year 2000, investment in both IT and non-IT in Singapore was quite comparable as a contribution to Singapore's economic growth to the corresponding contributions in China. Furthermore, between 1995 and the year 2000, investment in information technology in Singapore exceeded that in the United States as a contribution to economic growth. Singapore is not only one of the largest producers of information technology, hardware, and to some extent software, but it is also an economy that has been very, very effective in utilizing information technology to produce growth of the economy. We see, though, that in the year 2000, there was a severe downtrend in investment. And that's something that characterized the period from 2000 forward. Singapore is no longer growing at a rate like China. It is growing at a rate that is gradually approaching that of other advanced economies. Not only the four tigers, which you see here, Hong Kong, South Korea, and Taiwan, as well as Singapore, but advanced countries like the United States, like the countries in Europe, Canada, Australia. So Singapore has, in fact, taken a new growth path, one that relies very heavily on sophisticated use of information technology, but one that relies much less heavily than before the year 2000 on the growth of capital input. Well, that's the conclusion of my first topic. And just to summarize, the US experienced a huge boom in the contribution of information technology after 1995. Information technology has accounted for about half of the contribution of investment to US economic growth over the whole period from 1990 to 2009. Secondly, the trends in the world economy are similar, but much attenuated. And if we look specifically at individual countries, we find very divergent patterns from China, which is accelerating, Singapore, which is clearly decelerating at a much higher level, of course, and the other countries of developing Asia, which you see laid out here. Well, so much then for the contribution of capital input. What I'd like to do now is to turn my attention to the issue of the rest of the sources of economic growth, and that's the focus of the second part of my lecture. Well, let's then proceed to have a look at the sources of U.S. economic growth. So, in addition to capital input, which I've discussed now in detail, we have the growth of labor input, which can be separated into two components, the growth of hours worked and labor quality. So let me define these terms. Hours worked simply means what you would find on a typical payroll, the number of hours tabulated for each worker added up over the whole workforce. Labor quality is labor input per hour worked. Well, what can that mean? What it means is that labor input reflects not only the hours worked, but also the human capital embodied in each hour. An hour worked by somebody who is more highly educated or has more experience and therefore earns higher remuneration is something which generates more labor input than an hour worked by somebody with less human capital. And so we can reflect that very important distinction here between hours worked and human capital through this concept of labor quality. I've already defined the idea of total factor productivity growth, and it's simply the difference between the growth rate of output on the one hand and the growth rate of the inputs of capital and labor on the other. So that's the concept of productivity I'm going to use. Remember that economists also use the idea of labor productivity, but that's not a concept that I want to use as a source of economic growth. So the three sources of economic growth are going to be capital input, labor input, and total factor productivity. And these are the sources of economic growth that are going to give rise to the trends in the world economy that I've already described. Here's a picture of the sources of US economic growth. And you can see in blue the trends that I described earlier. These are the investments in information technology in dark blue and non-information technology in light blue. These are exactly the figures that I gave you before. What I've added here to this picture is the contribution of labor input in red. And I've divided that into two parts, growth in labor quality, added human capital per hour worked, and the number of hours worked. And we can see that there are very different trends here. From 90 to 95, there was a sizable growth of hours worked and labor quality, a lot of enhancement of the quality of the US labor force. From 95 to 2000, there was a boom, a very rapid expansion of hours worked, and slower growth of quality.
Then after the dot-com crash in the year 2000, hours worked actually declined slightly, but the quality of the labor force continued to improve. And then after the year 2005, hours worked became a negative source of growth, and labor quality continued, but at an enhanced rate. What about the role of total factor productivity? That's what's indicated in yellow. So that's output per unit of input. About 10% of US economic growth was due to gains in total factor productivity from 90 to 95. What is the significance of that? Total factor productivity reflects a very important component of growth, and that is the component of innovation. And when we look at the sources of economic growth, as I have here, with the growth of the US economy from 90 to 95 at about 2.3% per year, we can see that the contribution of innovation, output per unit of input, was no more than 10% of the total. What was the rest? The rest was largely replication, reproduction of existing units with the same capital outfit, the same workforce, over and over again. And that's reflected in the growth of the inputs. From 95 to 2000, there was a boom in innovation in the hardware-producing industries, like those here in Singapore. And the contribution of capital rose very substantially. The contribution of labor increased. But the contribution of innovation rose from less than 10% to more like 20%. From 2000 to 2005, innovation continued. But the nature of innovation was totally changed. It shifted from the hardware production of the information technology sector itself to the applications of information technology in services and trade. And then finally, from 2005 to 2009, total factor productivity actually went in reverse, became negative. This is a bit of a surprise. How could it become negative? During that period, of course, potential and actual GDP diverged, unemployment emerged, excess capacity, and that outweighed the growth of productivity, total factor productivity, due to innovation. So the conclusion is that overall, the contribution of innovation in this 20-year period to US economic growth amounted to less than 15% of the total of economic growth. The most important source of growth, as you can see, was capital. And within capital, the contributions of IT and non-IT were roughly balanced. Then finally, the second most important source of growth was labor, and the growth of hours turned out to predominate during the first half of the period, the growth of labor quality during the second half of the period. Well, so much for the US picture. Let's now look at the world economy. Same basic story, namely the most important source of growth for the world economy, which was growing at about 3% a year throughout this whole period, was capital in blue. The color scheme is the same as before. Dark blue is information technology, and light blue, non-information technology. In the world economy, information technology is relatively less important. If you look at the contribution of labor input to the world economy, you can see that hours worked has been predominant during the period from 95 to 2005. Before and after that, it was the growth of labor quality. Finally, if you look at the yellow, you see that the contribution of output per unit of input, innovation if you like, to world economic growth was no more than 20% of the total. Perhaps a little bit less. And that picture is very much like what we saw for the United States. You can look at the picture for developing Asia, but what I'd like to do is to have a look at the individual countries. And very much like the analysis that I gave you a moment ago, I'd like to focus on Singapore, obviously. So what we notice in the figures for Singapore is subtracting off the negative growth of total factor productivity during the period from 95 to 2000, 2005 to 2009,
The Singapore economy is an enormously volatile economy. Why is that? It's enormously volatile because of the fact that it's open to trade. Exports and imports actually dominate the GDP. And when we think about the movements of imports and exports, they're not perfectly synchronized. And the result of that is a very, very volatile picture, with very high growth at the beginning from 90 to 95, not quite comparable to China, but very high. Then a downturn from 95 to 2000, a slowing down, followed by something similar from 2000 to 2005. And finally, the dip that we saw earlier from 2005 to 2009. Overall, the most important source of economic growth for Singapore has been capital input. The next most important source of growth has been labor input. And if you compare across the countries of developing Asia, you see the remarkable growth of labor input in Singapore relative to the other countries. This is no news to you, but it's something that's not as widely appreciated as it should be. But something that is, in fact, quite remarkable is the fact that from 1990 to the year 2009, the contribution of innovation, total factor productivity growth for Singapore, was essentially zero. Now, of course, that figure would change. If we added to 2009, the year 2010, we would get a small positive contribution. Why is that? It's simply the case that Singapore has, for a very long time, had an advanced economy from the technological point of view. The process of catching up has been a process of investment and expansion of the labor force, not a process of more accelerated productivity growth. Compare that with China. There, the growth of labor input was fairly modest throughout the period. The contribution of this catch-up phase, indicated by multi-factor or total factor productivity, was very large. So we have a totally different picture here for Singapore and for the rest of developing Asia. Well, we have now arrived at the conclusion of my second topic. So what I'd like to do is to emphasize the points that I've made. The first point is that U.S. economic growth is something in which the most important single factor has been the growth of capital input. Secondly, the next most important factor is the growth of labor input. And finally, we find the contribution of innovation, or total factor productivity growth. So that's our basic conclusion from the analysis of the U.S. And it's rather similar for other industrialized countries. When we look at the analysis, though, for developing Asia, we find a very, very heterogeneous picture. And for Singapore, we find during the first half of the period high growth rates associated with very high levels of investment, rapid expansion of the labor force. During the latter period, less investment, but continued expansion of the labor force. And that pattern is the distinctive feature of the Singapore economy. But overall, for the world economy, we've had a period of very rapid growth. And now the question is, what is the future of the world economy? And that's the third and last topic that I'd like to address before turning the floor over to my discussants. Well, let's look carefully then at the story about projecting growth of the world economy. To project the growth of the world economy, we're going to rely on two forces. One force is going to be the force of demography, the population, and its composition. And so I'm going to focus on the growth of hours worked, which I'm going to take from labor force projections, and then I'm going to project the growth of labor quality from projections of educational attainment. So that's my methodology for dealing with the demography. Keep in mind that the demography is something which is not much affected by the other developments, by the level of investment, by the rate of innovation. It's something which has a role of its own that has to do with long-term forces in the growth of the population itself. The second component of my projections is going to be a contribution to productivity. And for that purpose, what I'm going to have to do is to try to project the growth of total factor productivity, the growth of capital quality, capital input per unit of capital, and closing of the gap between output and capital. And then finally, I'm going to project GDP as the sum of the growth of hours worked and labor productivity, using this information about demography and technology. Well, here's our picture of the future growth of labor productivity in the United States. So if I look at the average for the period from 1990 to 2009, the US economy grew at about 1.9% per year. Of that, thinking of this in terms of labor productivity now, output per hour worked, we see that the major part of that was what I'm going to call capital deepening, the amount, the contribution of capital relative to the number of hours worked, capital per unit of hours worked. And then finally, a contribution will arise from the growth of labor quality. That's the red bar that you see at the bottom. I've divided this between the base case, a pessimistic case, and an optimistic case. And let me simply describe for you the basic assumptions. For the base case, I've taken the average productivity growth throughout the period from 1990 to 2009 and simply assumed that the averages for total factor productivity and the other elements of technology are going to remain the same as this 19-year average. So that's my base case. I'm going to take my projection of labor quality from demographic information, and you can see that relative to the period from 1990 to 2009, the growth of labor quality is going to be considerably reduced. Why is that? The reason is the aging of the population. People now retiring from the labor force in the United States have relatively low levels of educational attainment by comparison with the young people who are coming into the labor force. And that has been a powerful force in U.S. economic growth from 1990 to 2009. But by 2010, which is the period covered by my projections here, we see that the forces to increase labor quality have diminished, because the young people coming into the labor force have about the same educational qualifications as people a decade earlier than that, or even a decade, 3 decades earlier. And so there's going to be a much slower growth of labor quality. The remaining problem is to project the growth of capital deepening. And the method that I'm going to use there is to require, for the United States at least, that capital and output grow at the same rate. Capital input and output grow at the same rate. And so that produces a reduction in capital deepening associated with the fact that there's a slowdown in labor quality. There will be no slowdown in the growth of output per unit of input, and so our base case projection involves a decline of labor productivity growth from 1.9 to 1.5%. An optimistic case would be to say that we're going to have the same developments in technology that prevailed during the boom from 95 to 2005. And that would produce a much higher rate of productivity growth, up near 2.5%. And a pessimistic case would be to say that this boom period was an exception, and we should average the period since 2005 and the period before 95, and that produces this pessimistic case of labor productivity growth of only 0.5%. Okay, that's the first part of my projection. The second part of my projection is that I'm going to add to the productivity, the dark color here, labor productivity growth, I'm going to add a projection of hours worked. So if I take my average from 90 to 2009, that's going to increase slightly. The U.S. labor force is going to grow slightly more rapidly than it did from 1990 to 2009. So that will be the same for the pessimistic case, the base case, and the optimistic case. What will differ among these cases is the projection of labor productivity growth. The base case, as you saw, was about 1.5%. So if we add to that 0.7, we get a GDP growth rate of around 2.2%, a considerable reduction from the 2.5, 2.6 range that prevailed over the last couple decades. Well, that's my projection then for the US, and now let's look at the story for the world economy. For the world economy, the growth rate will decline from an average from 1990 to 2009 of about 3.5% to something that's only a little bit more slow, something that is like 3.3%. So there will be a bit of a decline, and that decline can be traced to the decline in the growth rate of hours worked. The world population is slowing down, the growth of the labor force is gradually declining, and that being the case, there will be less capital deepening, and as you see, a slowdown in world economic growth. The picture for developing Asia is quite similar qualitatively, but the average rate of growth for developing Asia, around 7% per year over the last two decades, will give way to still a very high rate of growth. And that rate of growth is going to be around 6.3% per year. You can see the slowdown in the growth of labor input there, and of course, a bit of a slowdown in labor productivity growth. And then finally, let's look at the individual countries of developing Asia. Remember that the three trends that I identified are: one, that China is going to overtake the United States; two, that developing Asia is going to overtake the G7; and three, that there's going to be a new world order in which China, not the US, is going to be the leading country, the US would be second, India third, and so on. How does that emerge from these projections? Well, you can see the basic idea. China will continue to grow at very rapid pace, considerably below the period from 1990 to 2009, first of all, because of a slowdown in the growth of labor input in China. However, the growth of labor productivity will continue to be at a very rapid pace, and that's exactly what you see here. And so by 2018, China will overtake the US in terms of purchasing power parity. You can see that for the other countries of developing Asia, India, which is the second largest of the economies that you see here, is going to grow more rapidly than from 1990 to 2009. Why is that? Well, there's not going to be much of a slowdown in hours worked, and there is, in fact, going to be an acceleration of labor productivity growth. And that is reflected in recent figures on the growth of the Indian economy, which have actually been higher than those for China. So India and China together are going to result in a growth of developing Asia that is in excess of the G7, including the United States, Japan, the four major European countries, and Canada. And therefore, developing Asia is going to overtake the G7 by about 2018. What's the outlook for Singapore? Well, there are lots of uncertainties here. If you look at the figures for Singapore, you can see that we are projecting a very sizable slowdown in the growth of labor input. Why is that? That's because of the change in policy. In 2004, the Singapore government changed the policy with respect to immigration in a way that brings the growth of hours worked in Singapore back into line with the other countries in developing Asia. That will result in a slowdown in the growth of labor input, not a very substantial one, but nonetheless a slowdown, to about 2% a year. 2% a year is the target which has been announced by the Economic Strategies Committee in Singapore, and therefore this view of Singapore's future economic growth is perfectly consistent with the official position and the official goals. Remember, though, that that involves an acceleration in labor productivity from 1% a year during the last decade to 2% a year going forward to the next decade. Well, the rest of the picture is something you can easily see here, that the other countries of developing Asia are going to continue to grow more rapidly. But the four Asian tigers, Singapore, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Korea, are slowing down and behaving more and more like the advanced industrial economies that they have become. And that is the conclusion of the third topic in my lecture. Well, let me just wrap up and turn the floor over to my colleagues. The role of the U.S. in the world economy has obviously changed in a very fundamental way. It is permanently diminished and will continue to decline in relative terms, so that these trends have been established and are not likely to change. Unfortunately, this will result in a heightening of the confrontation between different parts of the U.S. Political spectrum that will result in continued stalemate in major issues in U.S. economic policy. To quote Winston Churchill, you can always count on the Americans to do the right thing after they've tried everything else. And that's something which I think we can look forward to. While the rise of Asia will be firmly established by 2020, pessimistic trends in demography have already undercut the growth of the Japanese economy and are shortly going to do the same in Korea and China. Demographic developments in Europe will also be a major drag on economic growth. However, the major focus is going to continue to be in Asia on capital deepening, and that's going to continue for a very long time into the future. Another focus that we need to emphasize is the importance of human capital. Human capital is something that is a very important element of economic growth, especially in developing Asia, and that is certainly going to continue in the future. In Singapore, I think that justifies the economic strategy's continued emphasis on upgrading enterprises and upgrading individual workers through continuing education to augment the existing system of education in Singapore, which is one of the most outstanding in the world. For professional economists, the task that remains is to construct an empirical theory of economic growth that can serve as a guide to policy. The U.S. and the other industrialized economies are going to remain far in advance of developing Asia in terms of per capita GDP, but the experience of Japan and the four Asian tigers tells us that advanced economies can emerge outside Europe and North America. And it's only a matter of time until these developments spread to China, to India, and to the major countries of developing Asia. Let me conclude by saying that the emergence of Asia from underdevelopment that persisted until the middle of the last century is the great economic achievement of our time. This has created a new model for economic growth built on two principles. One is the principle of globalization. Two is the principle of patient accumulation of human and non-human capital over the decade. This new growth paradigm obviously places an enormous premium on economic management, a very important opportunity, obviously, for the Singapore Management University. In Singapore itself, the premium on management is much higher than for other countries. Why? Because of the volatility associated with the openness of the Singapore economy. The performance of the leading economies in developing this paradigm, first Japan, then the Asian tigers, and now China and India, has changed the course of development in Asia and around the world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Jorgenson. Please take a seat on stage. We will be commencing our panel discussion shortly. I would now like to invite back on stage our chairperson, Professor Rajendra Srivastava. Professor Raj, please. May I now invite our panelists for today's discussion, Professor Tang and Mr. Yeoh, on stage. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the question and answer session. Please use the microphones at the aisles. Alternatively, you may raise your hand and we will provide a microphone for you.
I'd like to give Professor Jorgenson a break, maybe 2 minutes. Mrs. Jorgenson told me that your throat was running dry and you had to have some honey before you even got started. So now you got some irrigation there, so we'll give you a little bit of a break. Let me make a couple of comments on our other two panelists to give you a bit of the background. Professor James Tang is our international relations political science expert on stage. And you know, his background is in political science and international relations, and he holds the PhD from the London School of Economics and Political Science. His current research is focusing on the implications of the rise of China for international relations. So very apropos, you know, to this topic, what's the implication of the new order. I'd also like to introduce Mr. Yeoh Keong, and he's the Vice President for the Economic Society of Singapore. He was a senior economist and strategist at GIC for over 25 years. And he's been involved in global economic analysis and in investment research. So we will look upon you as an investment and financial expert in terms of the implications for the new economic order. And he holds a BSc and an MSc also from the London School of Economics. So it looks like we are overrepresented by LSE out here. One comment, I have a colleague and friend who's been referring to North America and Europe as submerging economies as opposed to emerging economies. And so we can note that in many of the figures that we saw in terms of in terms of the future, the productivity, the labor force, etc. And keeping that in mind, keeping the new economic order in mind, instead of the initial triad being the US, Japan, and Germany, shifting to the triad, the first three, of China, US, and India. If we look at that order and the remaining economies in that order, my first question is really to Professor James Tang. What does this imply in the international relations and the political landscape? We already see China having a very, very big impact in Africa. And India is trying to close in on China, but they're really far behind, for example, in Africa. So if you could comment on the implications of the economic order on the political scene.
Thank you, Chairman. Listening to Professor Jorgen's presentation as a political scientist and an international relations person, I was in a way relieved, but at the same time rather worried. Relieved that what we have been saying in the literature in international relations has been confirmed by very solid data, very persuasive methodology, that we are really seeing a fundamental shift in international relations. And I'm worried, because if such a shift is taking place, we are really facing tremendous challenges in terms of the world order that is also a theme of your lecture. Jeffrey Garton from your rival institution, Yeoh University, predicted that for the next several years, we can expect exceptional turbulence as the waning days of the global economic order we have known plays out chaotically, possibly destructively. So, well, he is also optimistic that something more promising would emerge. There would be a new set of international economic arrangements as this new economic order unfolds. But how do we get there from here. Professor Raj mentioned the role of new players like China. And I'm sort of wondering, in a way, two sort of separate issues but related. One, what would be the developments that could derail your projections? What if you were wrong, for example, which is unlikely, to be frank. But what are the things like, to what extent countries like China would not be able to maintain the kind of economic development growth as a result of various challenges, not necessarily only political, but also economic. People talk about, you know, to what extent China could move up one level in terms of its innovation. You mentioned the labor and services, and we are dealing with major demographic changes in China as well. But more positively, perhaps, countries like Singapore, to what extent they would be able to move out from the path you outlined, such as with slowing down of its economy following the pathways of a more industrialized economies. Are there variables and possibilities that we are going to see differences? And the sort of the second point I want to raise, as far as the China perspective is concerned, is which is in some way more worrying, is you are right. And then if you're right, then what are we going to deal with? What are the lineup for the new economic order? The new lineup in your presentation would be China, the United States, India, Japan, Russia, Germany, and Brazil. Compared to the old lineup, we are talking about a collection of countries with far greater diverse ideological outlooks, very different political systems, values, and facing very different type of economic and socio-political challenges. How far do you think they can sort of hang together? And instead of turning for a more cooperative economic development, then moving towards a situation when there would be far greater competitions in international relations literature, of course, we are worried about great power rivalry, power transition problems. And in the past, history told us that, well, power transition could happen peacefully, but the previous example was the United States and the United Kingdom, and they did have far greater commonalities, more like-mindedness. Now we are dealing with a very different set of players. So to what extent we have to deal with this new situation as this kind of new economic order emerges? Currently, I think people are talking about, instead of a group 20, instead of G20 or G7, we have a G0 situation when the United States is not able to exercise a kind of leadership in maintaining economic order. But then all these other so-called new economic players are also not ready to step into taking such leadership roles. And being the second largest economy, or even if it is the largest economy by 2018, does not necessarily mean that it has the kind of political will or influence and presence in maintaining a new economic order. So these are, I think, political science questions that we have difficulties answering. But perhaps we can have insights from the economists that can help us in tackling these kind of problems. Thank you.
I'm not sure if those are economic questions or political ones, but I'll let Professor Jorgenson have a shot at least one or two of them. I don't know how many questions you really had embedded.
I think that we have
been stuck with a model that goes back before the period of this analysis to 1989, before the collapse of the Soviet Union, where we see a rivalry as essentially the natural state of affairs, and the U.S., the leader of the free world against the forces of communism or whatever, as essentially the dominant model. For the last 20 years, we've been evolving in a different direction toward a multilateral perspective that I think is going to become increasingly relevant. Now, why is this change taking place? Well, obviously, the Soviet Union has been transformed into Russia and numerous additional republics. But the countries that have emerged have shared with China and with India and with Singapore and the other countries of developing Asia a commitment to globalization that was not part of the picture during the great U.S.-Soviet confrontation. So we're in a completely new situation. And we shouldn't be looking for a new leader, if you like, or a new form of hegemonism in which there is a either a single leader or a conflict. We should be looking for opportunities to cooperate in a global, an increasingly globalized economy. Now you can say, well, is everybody playing the same game? Is this something that is just the usual American optimism? I think not. I think if you look at the evolution of the recent debate over the leadership of the International Monetary Fund, the Chinese were focused on one question only, which is how do they gain a share of the leadership? And within the last few days, they did succeed. There is a Chinese managing director now of the International Monetary Fund. Now, why is the International Monetary Fund so important? The International Monetary Fund is the international organization that is responsible for supporting the G20. The G20 is essentially a voluntary group of people that meet every 6 months, if you think about the leadership. But underlying the process behind the G20 is an international coordination that is going to lead to increasing multilateralism through the institution of the periodic meetings of the G20, and on a month-to-month or week-to-week or day-to-day basis through international institutions like the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, and so on. Even as recently as, say, 10 years ago, people were thinking, no, what we really need to do is have Asian institutions that play this role. But Asia is now going to be the leader. And my feeling is that it is going to lead the world toward multilateralism. But I could be wrong. After all, I'm only an economist.
Okay, that provides me a good segue to our second panelist, and then I will open it up to the audience after this one. And it's commonly observed that money follows opportunities, so I'm assuming investments are going to follow the opportunities into Asia. And if we look at the new economic order, and what does that imply for some of the changes that you foresee in financial and investment strategies in the near future?
Well, I completely agree with Professor Jorgenson's very very interesting analytical journey through how Asia is going to essentially become the economic center of the world in 10, and even more so if you look out another 10 years beyond that and another 10 years, right? So the center of gravity of the world is going to shift back to Asia. And if you look at actually the incremental growth in the global economy over this period, the bulk of it actually comes from Asia. Therefore, also, so too, the bulk of the capital formation in the world, the bulk of the infrastructure formation in the world is going to come from Asia. And those kind of capital demands are going to generate a lot of investment need for investment opportunities. And this is beginning to actually make itself, these days, when you listen to investment prospectuses, everybody's telling you about Asia and the emerging world. But it will become increasingly a fact of life. I think there are some, there's both a lot of opportunity, but there's also, a fair degree of risk looking at as an investor. I think there are two kinds of, maybe there are three kinds of risk that I see in this kind of new environment where, for the first time in human history, Asia and the great Asian drama outlined by Gunnar Myrdal comes to a happy ending, right? And the first is that in this period, I think these economies, if you look at the institutional underpinnings of China or India, they are much less developed than the rapid rate of economic growth suggests. Like, for example, in China, you have a very rigid and a very underdeveloped banking sector, and you have hardly any capital, financial sector that is required to actually fuel this very much more variegated and very much more complex growth, which involves allocating capital much more selectively than it did in the previous labor catch-up period, right? You have tremendous degrees of friction in terms of political institutions, like, for example, the emerging middle class doesn't really have a political voice, and we haven't really seen in the past a major economy come to advanced economy per capita levels without effective political representation of the middle class, right? And that involves a major transformation in the political institutions of China, basically the Communist Party of China sharing power with the middle class. And how is that going to come about? I think it's a much more complex story than just accumulation of capital. So I think those kind of political risks do come up over this 10, 20 year period. And I'm not too sure that the resolution is going to be smooth. China also has to, besides reforming its capital markets, reforming its political system, it has to reform its relationship, its political relationship with its provinces, right? In the United States, that was a tricky issue. Involved a war, I recollect. and in China, there's a lot more wealth at stake, right? So I agree that on economic trajectory, it looks good. But I think I do have sympathies for Prof. Tang's idea that it's not going to be a smooth ride. And then there's the interactive. I agree. And if you look globally, so that's one set of risks, the set of domestic political reform that needs to occur in China and India for that growth trajectory to actually materialize without major mishap. I think there's also the international dynamics of that. There's political conflict potentially between a rising geopolitical rival and established geopolitical hegemon. But I think one has got to realize that it's going to happen in the context of, I believe, a conflict for natural resources that we have not seen in human history either. If you think about the commodity requirements, not just the capital requirements of this path of growth, right? If we think, let's say, 30 years out in the future, we're going to grow from a 60 trillion economy to 180 trillion economy, right? And we're going to involve massive amounts of infrastructure as essentially China and India urbanize, right? They move their populations from the countryside to the city, and all the commodities and iron and steel and energy that requires will place, I think, a major, if they are going to approach those kinds of output levels, going to strain the resources of the planet. And it's not clear immediately how this allocation is going to be done by market mechanism. Right now we're relying on relative prices essentially to do that allocation, right? But when we come to allocation of major goods like essential commodities like energy, like water, like arable land, you know, essential commodities, it's not clear that that can happen without a great deal of political conflict as well, right? So the international relations of how this is managed globally, I agree again with Prof. Tang, it's not clear. I think it's a multipolar world, and multipolar world typically doesn't manage, you know, things so well.
Okay. We've heard views from the panel now, and I'd like to move the questions to the floor. And if you would use one of the mics, or the mic will be brought to you, just please indicate your name and the organization you come from. And please, if you could ask a question instead of a sequence of three or four questions linked into one question. Thank you. Yes, please.
Thank you very much for your interesting and informative talk. My question is, I'm Edmund from the Ministry of Education. My question is, as educators, how do we promote greater innovation to generate higher TFP? Throughout, in the education system, what are your views in terms of promoting innovation? Since innovation plays such an important role.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have a one-word answer. Competition. So in order to promote productivity growth, the new mode that I tried to emphasize that has emerged in the United States over the last decade and is now spreading around the world is a mode in which the economy is increasingly aligned with the development of technology. And that requires competition among the different countries and different industries and so on to focus resources where the technology is leading us. And that will produce the growth in total factor productivity. So it seems to me that that's an opportunity that is already being exploited on a dramatic scale, as we saw in these figures, by the emerging economies of China and India. But there are similar opportunities in the US, in Singapore, in Japan, in Europe, that are not being exploited. And we need to think of how to move in that direction. So that would be my answer to your question about innovation, competition. I'm much more sanguine about the outlook, obviously, than you are. And I think the reason is that I have a great deal more confidence in the functioning of markets. So I think that the common commitment of India and China to a world order based on globalization and based on market processes is something that is a tremendous strength for the world economy going forward. And there are lots of things that could result in some kind of breakdown. Imbalances that the G20 is trying to address, which are present in the United States and in China and India and so on. But I think that these are imbalances that will have to be addressed. And they're going to be a source of a lot of tension, both within countries and between them. There are also a lot of imbalances across countries that we're familiar with. So this is going to be a rough ride. That's exactly what you suggested, and I think that's exactly right. And there are lots of things that could go wrong. We saw from 2007 to 2009 the threat of something that could go very, very badly wrong. And it's not over. We still have lots of things that could go wrong and derail the process that I've tried to lay out before you. So I think that this has become an opportunity for all of us to look at a broader point of view. Economics by itself is not going to do it. So I'm very, very sensitive to the view that this is becoming increasingly a problem to be addressed not only by economists, financial analysts, but political scientists, essentially by the general citizen of the world. And we've got to change the terms of our debate and get on with it. That's what I'd like to lay before you as a proposition.
Other questions?
Hi, I'm Venkat from SMU. My question is, new economic order leads to a new political order. Current, if you look at the current political order in terms of, in the context of regional conflict and so on, we have the Security Council where these matters are referred to. Two of the Security Council members, UK and France, don't even figure in the new economic order of the top seven countries that you mentioned. So what would be the new world order if we link up both the new economic order and the new political order? Where, what are we looking at? We're talking about India, Brazil, etc. being included in the Security Council, but without veto powers, that's a meaningless addition. So in your opinion, or in the opinion of the panelists, what do we foresee in the new economic order, which would be a new world order, be a combination of economic and political order?
Well, let me respond on the economic order part of it. What I tried to suggest is that the international institutions that are most relevant to the immediate future development are institutions like the Asian Development Bank, the World Bank, the European Development Bank, the African counterpart, and most importantly, the International Monetary Fund, which has increased enormously in importance over the last 5 years or so. These are the institutions that I think are going to carry us forward into the future. You're quite right that if we look at the United Nations, which is supposed to be the political coordinating body of the planet, we're looking at a structure that reflects a totally different economic order. And so I defer to people who are better informed than I, and I'd like to hear the opinion of the other members of the panel.
I think the most interesting development in terms of global governance is the G20. And it did play quite a critical role, I think, in stabilizing the global financial situation. And to what extent we are seeing new modes of dealing with new problems. I would hope that groups like G20 could be able to play a more active role, but there are also challenges. For a start, even though it represents the majority of the world's population and the leading economies, but it doesn't really, I think it still has a representation problem compared with the United Nations and some other groups. And the other one is increasingly I can see that G20 has, look at what happened in South Korea, for example, it seems to have been turned into more an opportunity for the host nation to drive its national agenda, and to what extent that could, I don't think it could be completely prevented, but to what extent G20 could somehow continue to have vitality in addressing broader transitional issues as it tackles all these newly arising problems. But I'm less optimistic about fundamental reforms at the United Nations in, for example, changing the membership of the Security Council or creating a new economic council to deal with some of these issues.
Hi, good evening, distinguished panelists. My name is Edmund. I'm from the Economic Development Board, and I'm also an alumni of the SMU School of Economics. So my question for you is that in like that, one thing I saw on the slides was that Singapore is experiencing negative total factor productivity, and this seems to imply that we are having diminished returns to maybe capital inputs. And given that, in the last 5 years, I think there has been a shift in mindset of the EDB from a growth at all costs kind of mindset to a more sustainable economic development mindset. So I would like to seek your comments on what do you think in the next 5 and the next 10 years, what are your comments for capital input growth vis-a-vis the other areas of growth such as human capital as well as total factor productivity? Which will be more important in the future?
Well, I think it's quite clear that the role of capital input is extremely critical to high rates of growth like those that prevailed in Singapore before the year 2000 and those that are characteristic of China and India today. But the distinction between the tigers, the Asian tigers, and China and India is one of scale. I mean, it's just a staggering scale of the economy that we're confronted with. And so I would say that we're going to rely much more heavily in the development of China and India, not only on capital, but also on catching up. I mean, these countries are so poor relative to where Singapore was, for example, 35, 40 years ago, that it's something that is going to have to be addressed by continuing advances in technology. So I think we need a balanced approach, but there's no doubt that economic growth is going to slow down in China. It's going to slow down in India, just as it's slowing down in the Asian tigers. And that's why I think that this problem of international coordination is becoming increasingly manageable rather than less manageable. And that's why I'm optimistic that the kind of developments that are going to lead to a world economy that is twice as large as the world economy that we have today can be handled in a way that will preserve stability. But there are going to be some rough patches, there's no doubt about it.
Okay. Well, I'd like to thank our panelists and the audience. And that brings to an end our session. And
thank you, Professor Jorgenson, Professor Tang, Mr. Yeoh, and Professor Raj. Please remain on stage. We would now like to invite Professor Raj to present tokens of appreciation to our speaker, Professor Jorgenson, as well as our external panelist, Mr. Yeoh. Professor Raj, please. Thank you, Professor Raj. We have now come to the end of the lecture. We would like to thank our distinguished speaker, Professor Jorgenson, our panelists, Professor Tang and Mr. Yeoh, our generous donor, Ms. Priscilla Shaw and the Shaw Foundation, as well as all our guests for joining us here this evening. Thank you for your participation. Please join us for some light refreshments outside the auditorium. Have a great evening ahead.